2025年10月3日，一个来自太阳系外的访客，星际物体 3i Atlas， 从火星身边擦肩而过，最近是大约3000万公里。这个距离在宇宙里不算近到触手可及，但对于望远镜来说已经足够看清样子，是一次难得的近距离路过。这次走进火星的窗口，让在轨的火星探测器能够近水楼台先得月的拍照测光测速，可谓前所未有。它不仅让我们第一次从旁观习而不是远观习研究星际访客，还把研究他们如何与太阳光太阳风互动的进度往前推了一大步。欧洲与俄罗斯合作的 ExoMars 微量气体轨道器上搭载的彩色立体表面成像系统 CASIS 率先出手，从火星上空的轨道视角抓下了 3i Atlas 的第一批定格画面。 CASIS 生成了一组彩色照片，画面里 3i Atlas 在背景密密麻麻的恒星前面像一个微微散开的光点，不是针尖般锐利，而是朦朦胧胧。为了让这颗暗淡的过客浮出画面，他们使用了5秒长曝光，在约3000万公里的距离上把光线攒够了。这批图像的可用度和早期的哈勃观测差不多，但优势在于离得更近，因此对它周围的彗发，也就是那团被照亮的气沉云，能看得更细，结构层次更清楚。反过来看，火星快车轨道器只用了 0.5 秒曝光，结果就看不见这位访客了。这个对比很直观，遇到这种又远又暗的目标，不拉长曝光时间，光子不够，就等于没拍到。 CASIS 的成像精度用角分辨率来衡量，每个像素覆盖 11.36 微弧度，换算成更常用的单位是大约 2.34 角秒。简单说，就是能在极小的角度差里分出细节。这个数值直接规定了相机能看多细的上限，角分辨率越小，照片里可分开的细节就越多，模糊的边界就越少。把角分辨率换算到实际距离上，在3000万公里这么远的观察几何里，意味着画面中一个像素代表大约340公里，相当于一张照片里的每格子就是一个省的宽度。所以 CASIS 拍到的主要是围着它的那层亮气雾挥发，至于真正的硬核本体，像是一粒小石子躲在雾里。这个分辨率还够不着，目前估算这个核心大小很谦虚，直径大约在5到46公里之间，从一座城到一个小县的尺度，放到宇宙里就是麻雀虽小五脏俱全。照片里看起来糊的原因不是对焦失败，而是它自己在冒气，喷出的气体和细尘在和周围形成一团云雾，把轮廓自然抹揉了。具体来说，这种朦胧感来自持续的气体释放，成分大概率是二氧化碳。这种挥发性强的气体一受太阳加热，就会从表面逃逸出来，气体往外跑，带出微小尘粒，被阳光一照就亮起来，于是围着核心形成一圈发光外衣，在照片里就像一枚柔光灯下的亮点。来自 SPHERX 的数据提示，这束二氧化碳气柱至少能从核心往外拖到 34.8 万公里那么远，这已经不只是尾巴，而像是一条宏大的气体长廊。这么夸张的延伸长度，直观地说明了它的活跃程度，不是偶尔冒一口气，而是持续成规模的喷发。 CASIS 的图片还显示，这片亮区朝着太阳方向拉长，长宽比大约10比1，长度达数千公里。这种被拽长的形状和太阳辐射压力把微粒往外推的效应完全对得上。简单理解，太阳光不仅照亮它，也在推它。轻微但持续的光压把气体和尘粒往远处赶，拉出一条修长的结构。更巧的是，火星轨道器这次的观测角度几乎是侧着看，也就是对着它与太阳连线的侧面，这让科学家能更完整的量一量这条延伸到底有多长多细。相比在地球上斜斜的看，这种观测几何更占便宜，彗发的层次厚薄形状变化 都能在图像里更清楚地分辨出来。与此同时， NASA 的火星勘测轨道飞行器 MRO 上那台名声很响的相机 HiRISE 也在上镜，准备用它的超清能力补足细节。 HiRISE 的核心是一只直径50厘米的大口径望远镜，本来就是为了把火星地表拍到纤毫毕现，如今转过来对准 3ILS 更能发挥放大镜的优势。以这次观测的距离来算， HiRISE 能达到每像素约30公里的清晰度，这已经是同类观测里相当顶尖的放大级别。和 CASS 的每像素340公里相比， HiRISE 等于把一个像素的砖块缩小了10倍有余，细节自然就浮出来了，模糊边界也更容易被拨开。对 3ILS 而言， HiRISE 的图像最有希望给出目前为止最靠谱的和大小上下限，把那个5到46公里的范围再往精确里收一收，靠着更高的分辨率，我们有机会第一次把核合物真正分开看，得到关乎质量、反照率、活动强度等关键参数的更坚实依据。天体物理学家阿维·勒布在接受 NBC News 采访时对此予以了解，读看 HiRISE 图像里最亮的那几个像素，就能对核的直径给出最有力的限制。亮度峰值往往对应最集中的本体。他的意思很直白， NRO HiRISE 的超清成像首次让这个外来核的真实大小有机会被明确定量，这是过去那些更远更糊的观测做不到的。下面我们来具体看看勒布是如何解读这一最新影像的。
And let's get into it with one of our favorite interstellar experts, Harvard professor Avi Loeb. Professor, welcome back. Starting with these new images from AESA's ExoMars orbiter, what stands out to you? Any surprises here?
Well, the fact is that we see an image very similar to the Hubble Space Telescope image that was obtained on July 21st, qualitatively speaking. Of course, the Hubble Space Telescope has a much bigger mirror, 2.4 meters in diameter, whereas this camera that was used on ExoMars is much smaller. As a result, it can the low surface brightness in the envelope surrounding the core of the plume of the glow around the 3I Atlas. And I calculated that, in fact, the resolution of the camera of ExoMars is about 340 kilometers. And we see that the image, the glow around 3I Atlas, is about 2 resolution elements, 2 pixels. We can tell that because the stars are point sources in the background, and they have a width that is roughly half of the width of the image of 3I Atlas. So altogether, we can see the core that was already apparent in the Hubble Space Telescope image. Of course, there is a much better camera that we hope to get the data from. It's the high-rise camera on the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter that is 50 centimeters in diameter and therefore will allow us a pixel size of 30 kilometers when 3I Atlas was closest to Mars at a distance of 30 million kilometers. The challenge there is that NASA is currently under government shutdown, and so we cannot get any communications from NASA, and that prevents the flow of data that was already obtained.
Yeah, so that data has already been collected. That picture, those images, they already exist. It's just we have no idea when we're going to see them, right?
Right. People ask me about the government shutdown, whether there is any conspiracy to hold off the data from the public side. And I said, the delay is not a signature of extraterrestrial intelligence. It's more a signature of terrestrial stupidity.
Yeah, which we have quite a bit of here on Earth. You've also spoken about, and you know, speaking of conspiracy theories, like you just wrote about the first images from NASA's Perseverance rover, and this got a lot of people talking, specifically that distinct stripe that had many people thinking that we were looking at a massive Manhattan-sized cylinder or possibly a tube there, and that looks very different from the images that we just saw captured. Can you explain the difference here? Are we looking at some sort of like motion blur?
Yeah, this is just motion blur. It may be one of the two moons of Mars, either Phobos or Deimos. Again, because of the government shutdown, there is not much information about the direction where this image was taken. And I calculated that it's fully consistent with a long exposure of over 10 seconds of one of the moons of Mars. And of course, what you would see in such an image is a sequence of spheres that are just like beans on a pod, you know, and that's what we see as an elongated image. There was a lot of speculations on social media, but I figure that either it's one of the moons, most likely one of the moons of Mars, or perhaps a very long exposure of 3A Atlas. But in all cases, it has nothing to do with the cylindrical shape of the source. It's more to do with the exposure being long and seeing many images of the source, one after the other, as it moves across the Martian sky.
And every time we do this, I think I'm going to ask you at the end, like, on the Loeb scale, how are things looking based on the limited information that you've gotten so far? Still looking comedy?
Well, between, I would say, 30-40% that it's not a natural object, because we don't see a beautiful tail behind this object the way we see around comets. I think most likely it's natural, but nevertheless, it has all these anomalies that make it unusual. It's in the plane of the planets around the sun. It's also coming close to Mars and Jupiter. It's very big. Apparently, relative to the previous objects that we found from interstellar space. And then it also had this extension glow towards the sun rather than away from the sun. And so we have to monitor it and figure out whether it's of any technological origin that could pose a threat to humanity. And I wrote to the United Nations a white paper suggesting that there will be a committee evaluating all the signatures of star objects to alert us against any potential threats.
I mean, I know it's just a ballpark, but 30-40% that it could be something else, that is pretty significant coming from you. Avi Loeb, Professor, thank you so very much.
现在科学界都在等 HiRSE 的最新影像数据落地，分辨率再上了一档，很多含糊其辞的参数就能收紧，模型也能从粗描升级到工笔。每像素30公里的细节意味着，科学家有望把核和彗发在图上真正分开，用亮度分布和形状剖面来做更准的尺寸测量，同时推断内部结构与挥发物的成分比例。当然 CASAS 的成果是很好的起点，每像素340公里的画面帮我们先确认了目标、形状和亮度水平，但要说掰开揉碎看细节，还得靠 HiRSE 来补上关键一环，两台相机的互补，说明多分辨率、跨平台联合观测的必要。近的、远的、粗的、细的一拼接，就能把过去因距离太远或清晰度不够而藏起来的信息揪出来。这次从火星轨道成功拍到 3Atlas， 也是一堂活生生的协作课。不同机构的卫星各展所长，拼出完整图景。效率和质量都上去了，从欧洲航天局到 NASA， 再到中国与阿联酋的航天团队，这样的国际协作，把多种波段、多种轨道、多类仪器串了起来，对这种少见的星际天体，提供了更全面、更可靠的数据。累积起来的观测，让我们能更系统地理解，当一个外来访客闯进太阳系，它释放什么，怎么释放，受太阳辐射和引力怎样牵引，这些化学与物理的合奏到底长什么样。 具体做法就是钉排气的形态和彗发的轮廓。亮度随距离怎么变，形状在哪收在哪放。从这些指纹到推出气体成分、颗粒大小以及受光压和引力作用的动态过程。接下来研究重点会落到 HiRSE 的全套数据上。核心目标很明确，把核的直径量准量稳，为后续的物理性质推断打好基准线。凭借每像素30公里的清晰度、反照率、表面反光程度和密度等参数的模型都能升级迭代，达到地面望远镜难以企及的精度层级。更长远看，这不是纯粹的看个热闹，了解这类外来天体的个性和脾气，对行星防御，也就是如何应对潜在危险访客，是实打实的技术储备。当各国把力量拧成一股绳，把大小、成分、轨道这些身份信息摸清，我们就能设计更灵敏的探测、更稳妥的跟踪，以及必要时的风险缓解方案，为地球构筑一道更可靠的防护网。